Hi, I'm Anatole Kreitzer. I'm an investigator at the Gladstone Institutes, and I'm here to talk about how concepts from business development can be applied to your academic laboratory. So you've learned about the definition of business development and how businesses use business development to fill its pipeline, to bring their products to market, and to serve their stakeholders. And now we're going to elaborate a little bit more about how laboratories actually use many of these same concepts. So in the first half of the presentation, you learned about how companies identify various gaps that can hinder the development of their products. Now, in academia, we can actually use very similar concepts because the development of an academic lab actually has many parallels to the development of a company. So for example, it's important for an academic lab to continually survey the field and identify gaps that can be met by the laboratory. So for example, one of the major goals of going to scientific meetings is to actually become aware of the very latest research and to think about how one might apply the strengths of one's own laboratory to actually meet some of these needs. Similarly, it's very important to review manuscripts for journals because you then become aware of sort of very recent up-and-coming topics that can also help guide the laboratory. And similarly, serving on grant review panels can serve much of the same goal. So it's very important as a primary investigator to actually keep abreast of the field and consider strategically in the next 5 years what sorts of areas should the lab think about moving into. Now within the lab, there may also be gaps. Particularly in the beginning of a laboratory, you may not have all the requisite techniques available to address the questions you're interested in. So you need to think very carefully about how you can bring these techniques to bear. And of course, there are various ways to do this. You can either finance the acquisition of various tools and methods, or you can actually partner. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. And of course, financial gaps. Now, I think most laboratories are familiar with the concept of financial gaps. But of course, it's very important to continually be surveying so RFAs from granting agencies. It's also important to establish connections to disease foundations and also sort of consider other sources of funding that may be available. Now, in the second half of the presentation, you learned about how companies actually determine which vehicles can best fill a particular gap, how they execute that particular deal, and then measure the success. So when considering parallels to academia, it's important to think about what sort of vehicles a laboratory can actually bring to bear to meet its goals. And I think one of the most important vehicles is the collaboration, or essentially partnering. So this is in concept quite similar to the type of partnering that companies do. It's based on when a laboratory has a particular need that they cannot address internally, either due to cost or lack of expertise. And so it becomes very important to actually consider which other laboratories one might consider partnering with to achieve goals. Now, establishing collaborations is a tricky business. One must, again, go out, give seminars, go to meetings, meet with people, and really discuss various ideas and pitch your project to people. Because in the end, you're going to have to ultimately convince someone else, another laboratory, to actually take time and effort and money to actually partner with you to achieve goals. And so, of course, an ideal collaboration actually involves benefits for both parties. So how do you negotiate such a collaboration? Well, in principle, in academia, these negotiations typically tend to be fairly casual. On the other hand, this can often lead to problems. So whereas in industry, these deals are actually explicitly written out in the form of contracts, typically academic deals are essentially oral agreements. Now, this can lead to deals gone bad. I can give you one example from my own experience. I established a collaboration with a postdoc in another lab, and this collaboration was going to be of limited scope initially. And I actually put this postdoc in touch with somebody in my lab, and I kind of let them go. And a month went by, another month went by, and actually ultimately about a year went by, and this project was still ongoing. And this particular postdoc had then transitioned actually to become a principal investigator themselves and was continuing to use the postdoc in my laboratory to conduct experiments. And at some point, I recognized that this deal needed to be renegotiated. And so at that point, I actually stepped in and said, we need to step back. The situation has changed significantly from the initial conception of this collaboration, and things need to change. So it's really important, I think, to continually reassess these type of collaborations, particularly in the absence of explicit milestones and contracts. So on the other hand, I think good deals can actually be a huge benefit to the lab. So if you can find a laboratory with complementary expertise that has share similar interests, and ideally a collaboration can actually lead to papers from both laboratories so that essentially both laboratories can get senior author papers out of the deal. This is really the ideal collaboration. It's sort of everybody's a winner, and there's not this sort of one-sided deal where one lab wins and the other lab loses. So I think this is really the best way to structure such academic collaborations. So with that, I will thank you for watching.